I'm John Doyle, the Artistic Director of Classic Stage Company, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to Classic Conversations. For quite a long time now, we've been presenting this series of informal chats between myself and artists that I know and admire. There's nobody that I admire more than this week's guest, the legendary John Kander. How are you, John Kander?
It's great to see you. It's like, I don't know, it's people used to have lunch together.
I know. You and I used to have lunch in a diner. Yeah. Round the corner from where you live in the city, we used to go for lunch, I remember.
Yeah, it's a place called the Bistro.
That's it.
And there's a little thing in the back, little place in the back that I call my office.
That's it. That's where we used to go when we were talking about The Visit. Exactly. I've always been like amazed and impressed, and it's made me feel small that you still are working. That you've never sat back on your laurels and thought, I don't need to work anymore. You're still writing.
Yeah. Well, why did we do it in the first place?
I know.
If I didn't like it, I wouldn't do it.
But I mean, when Fred Ebb passed, did that make you stop and think, do I stop now or I've got to find somebody else? How did all that, obviously other than your loss of your dear colleague and friend, how did that pan out?
That element, in terms of decision, that wasn't complicated. It took me time to get my bearings.
I'm sure.
But it's, why would I stop doing the thing that makes me happy?
Incredibly happy.
You're the same. I mean, or have you quit? You haven't quit.
No, I haven't quit. No, but I'm 2 years younger than you.
Two. No, I'm 90. I'm about to be 94. So,
Well, I'm 68. No, I'm not about to quit. No.
But can you imagine? Okay, can you imagine yourself quitting?
No, I can imagine myself doing less. I can imagine the one thing that this time has made me think is, oh, it's quite nice. It's nice being at home with Robert. It's nice. I mean, I love being in the rehearsal room. You know that. We've been in the same rehearsal room together. I love it. But it's nice not to have to kind of stop one and then do the next one. It's in a funny way. It's the first time in my life that I've not been going from show to show, which is a very privileged position to have been in. But it's not felt as bad as I thought it would. Now, I'm still doing a lot of work for Classic Stage. It's a different kind of work, John, but there's a lot of work going on. And I still
teach. That's a whole executive thing, which
that's a whole other thing. Yeah. At the moment, that's just about how do we get through next week? You know, it's about raising money and doing all that stuff. And then I teach still at Princeton, and I love that. So I'm feeling quite, my creativity is fine. But I'm surprised that I haven't missed the rehearsal room more than I have. It's interesting. I thought I would, but it's not been as bad as I thought it would be. So listen, let me take you all the way back, though, not quite the beginning of these 94 years. But your family weren't theater people, were they?
No. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri. And there were no professional musicians or theater people in my family, but music was always there. And somehow or other, it was a family that loved all these things. My father had a big booming voice. It was quite beautiful. People
really
loved music. And my aunt who lived with us played the piano, and my grandmother played piano and had studied, and my brother loved to sing, and this is going to sound too cute by half, but it's true. we would sometimes after dinner, we'd go in the living room and just make music. And I would play and Dad would sing and my brother would sing and my aunt would play. And my mother, unfortunately, was tone deaf, but she had rhythm. And so every once in a while, Dad would say, play a march for your mother. And I would. I'd play a march and Mom would get up from the chair and she'd march around the chair. Oh,
that's fantastic.
That was her contribution to the evening. So none of it had any sense of you should do this for a living, or it was all about, it was all about the thing itself. So yeah. I was lucky enough to have some talent, and but it was never about exploiting it. And it was always about, if that's what you want to do, do it as long as it fulfills you, but not for the glamour or the glory or seeing name anywhere.
Sure. So did you go straight from school to Oberlin?
No, there was this war.
Oh, of course.
I didn't kill anybody.
Not then. So you did national service first.
I was in a Navy Merchant Marine program near the very end of the war, and I was back and forth in the Pacific to the Philippines and China on two or three trips, and then this gets really complicated. Then I got out and got ready to go to school. And then I got drafted because the Congress had decided that that area of service that I was in didn't count. And so I was in the Army for a year until they said, no, we made a terrible mistake. They let us all out. And then I went to Oberlin.
Then you went to Oberlin. So you didn't ever have to do Korea or anything like that. That was late. That was later.
Oh, yeah, that was... though I did, never mind, it's really complicated, but I did get drafted again. But I did not have to go to Korea. I never had to fight anybody.
Yeah, but they kept drafting you. That is so funny.
They just couldn't run a war without me.
Of course, like the American theater. So listen, how did you, I mean, I didn't know, because being British, I said to Judy Kuhn rather innocently one day, is Oberlin a famous school for music? And she said, yes, that's why John Kander went there. And was it a famous school for music when you went there?
Yes, but it was a very specific kind of place. I didn't want to go to have a conservatory experience. I wanted to have an education. Uh-huh. And at Oberlin, which had a fine conservatory within it, that was very musically oriented, but you could get a regular bachelor's degree and in English and in music. And anyway, to get an education, it was I've been very lucky in my life. I had so the years I spent there, it was the perfect place for me.
Wonderful.
And a friend of mine there, a young Greek director named Nikos Sakharopoulos.
Yes.
He was in my class, and the two of us started a theater together. We found an old shack on a park that they were going to tear down. And then we went to the administration and asked if we could have it. And they let us have it. And we conned a lot of people into painting it. And we did theater.
He's the same Nikos who who was Williamstown, where we were.
Yes, Williamstown is his invention.
Yes. I had not put together your connection with him, having worked together at Williamstown. I didn't know that.
Anyway, it was all very self-indulgent, but it was ours. And I love Nikos. His accent got thicker the older he grew.
It was to his advantage to be Greek, be exotic, of course. So did you go then straight to New York City after?
I went to Columbia to get my master's, and I had an assistantship in the opera workshop, and which again was really fortunate, because I really got to learn the repertoire.
Yeah.
As an accompanist and as a coach, and it was a good period.
And I mean, I remember when we were working on the visit, and I would come to your house, and Terence was there, dear Terence McNally, that the two of you would talk opera very easily. I mean, at the drop of a hat, you were talking about what was happening at the Met.
We had that very much. That was a big bond between us, because
I could see that.
God, I miss him. Oh, shit.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. What a terrible, terrible loss. But did you ever think of going, becoming an opera conductor?
No. I studied conducting, and I used it. It was fortunate. I was able to conduct in stock and a company and coach singers. I had some skills which allowed me not to starve.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
And again, being really lucky, they were all in one way or another involved with the theater. I don't know if they have it these days, but we were in a tent, and we did a show a week, and I'm very, very grateful for that experience, because it's insane to try to do a show a week, but when you have to, and it sort of seeps in, it's not an academic thing, but you know what you have to go for. That's you right. Have no time to do nice things.
That's right. When I started directing, first of all, it wasn't a week, but there were 10 days to 2 week rehearsal periods, right? And in fact, if you ever got a 3 week rehearsal period, you thought you'd died and gone to heaven. But I mean, I remember doing, I shouldn't tell you this really, but I remember directing Cabaret in repertory in Britain, your musical. First time I did, I've done it three times. And the first time I did it, we had a 2 week rehearsal period, and we did it. And you know, it was good. I mean, it's not as if it was bad work that was churned out. You had a lot of people who were very skilled at working very quickly. And it's not that they weren't thinking about what they were doing or analyzing it or anything like that, but they knew how to learn quickly and make quick choices. And I certainly have found that invaluable as a director.
I was going to say, don't you find, from I'm sure you do, that having that experience really sort of helps you focus on what's the essential?
Totally. Totally, totally, totally. And actually, if somebody comes, I should never say these things, because if there's the producer listening, I'm in trouble. But if somebody says to me, oh, you can have 6 weeks, I start to panic. I think, oh my God, what am I going to do? You know, my mind is so used to thinking in shorter periods of time. Now, nowadays I like 4 weeks, but
it's funny, because we had a director named Ed Greenberg who was brilliant at doing 1 week. I mean, what he got out of 1 week rehearsal, and he was asked to direct a show on Broadway, and he went into complete panic, and he turned it down eventually. He said, because I don't know what to do with 4 weeks.
I know. I know. It's so interesting. And of course, with me, in my case, you might remember back to when we worked together, you know, I wasn't raised in a world where everybody did table work and workshops and readings. I mean, we didn't do that stuff. You started on the first day and you got up on your feet. You know, that's what you did. And so I still find all that rather alien, really. But you were in rehearsal rooms like, you know, before you started, I'm sure you were writing your own work, but before you became John Kander, you were in, you know, you were in West Side Story rehearsal room, you were in the Gypsy rehearsal room, you were doing dance arrangements for those shows?
Not for West Side.
Not for West Side.
I just came in as a 3-week sub, but it was very lucky for me though, because it was right where they're doing a lot of changeover in cast. So I had to rehearse with them during the day. And then the story is so long.
Tell a little bit of it, go on.
This is you can edit this whole fucking thing out. This is the story of how I had a career at all. If this had not happened, I would never have had a career. I was in Philadelphia. I was conducting an off-Broadway musical called, conversation piece.
Okay.
And the guy who was doing the orchestrations for it was in Philadelphia doing another show. So I met him there. And somehow or other, after that afternoon meeting, I got a ticket for West Side Story, which was opening that night in Philadelphia. Anyway, it was obviously an extraordinary event. And we were at the, stop me anytime you want.
Go on, please, how could I? Go on.
There was a party at a big hotel, and somehow or other I was there, and there was a huge bar in the center, and it was about 5 or 6 people deep. And I'm not a very aggressive fellow, and I was going sort of like this to get, and this little short man was standing in front of me, and he saw my distress. And he said, what do you want? And I'll order yours when I order mine. And which I thanked him, and he did. And he ordered my drink. We talked for a while, and he was the pianist with West Side. And we became sort of friends, not close or anything, but we kept in touch. And toward the end of the year, after, he was going on a 3-week holiday and he needed a sub. And he asked me if I wanted the job. I said yes a lot in those days.
Of course.
So I had 3 weeks where I took over his job. And those were the weeks I said whatever he was coming in and rehearsing. And Ruthie Mitchell, who was the stage manager, did you know her?
No, I didn't. She had gone before I came to New York. Yes.
Anyhow, she was the stage manager, and she got used to me. And so she was starting on a new show with Robbins called Gypsy, and they were auditions. They were going to do weeks and weeks of auditions. And she asked me if I wanted to do it. And I said, yes.
Yes.
So for about 6 weeks, I was there in the theater playing auditions for Gypsy. And Robbins got used to me. And he said, literally, this is the quote because I'll never forget it. He said, hey, do you want to do this show with me? And I gulped and I said, do you want me to? And he said, yeah. And I said, yeah. And so I was rehearsing Gypsy out of town and doing the dance arrangements and and rehearsal piano as well. And Gypsy was very successful, and because of that, I got a sort of reputation, I guess, as being a dance ranger, because Irma LaRouche was going into it.
Yeah.
And so they called me and asked me if I wanted to do the dance arrangements, and I said, yes.
How amazing.
And that was much more extensive and in many ways more fun. But after that, and you know this perfectly well, and I think people in general don't, the Broadway community is very small.
Very small.
And I think your entrance card into that community is simply being professional.
That's it.
And once you get through that, you walk through that curtain where people think, oh, this is somebody who
I know
can do the job. And so he's dependable. And so after that, it seemed to me that I was able to work.
I don't know if I've ever told you this, but I did a British revival of Irma LaRouche.
Ah.
And I actually did it at Encores too, but I did a British revival and with Monty Norman and Julian Moore, you'll remember them. And and then I remember when we did Liz Seal, the original Irma LaRouche, came to see it. Of course, she's such a lovely woman.
Oh,
and then Monty Norman and Julian Moore asked me if I would write a musical with them. So we wrote, it was never done, but I wrote the book, they did lyrics and the music about the novel Lucky Jim. And I had such fun with them because being in a room with them, you know, they're from a whole other time. You know, Espresso Bongo that Monty wrote. I mean, like a whole British other time. It was a fascinating thing. But I think Irma LaRouche is a sweet piece. But I think the thing that always amazes me about Irma LaRouche is that Peter Brook directed it, of all people in the world.
Well, he was another part of the story because he was still pretty young then.
Yeah.
And me being an opera crazy person. And knowing Peter's work, during that period when we were rehearsing, we got to be friends, and he told me wonderful stories. And then I also learned, I was sitting in the last row during a tech rehearsal, and things were going crazy on the stage, and Keith Michelle was upset about something and was weeping as he left the stage. And somebody else was doing it. And Peter was just as calm as a cucumber. And I was sitting there, and then I realized there was a considerable thermos of martinis. So I think, now I know your secret.
That's how to stay calm, be on those martinis. When I was in tech for Sweeney Todd on Broadway, one night, it was, you know, one of those, I don't do long tech nights, but you know, it was the middle of the evening, and Patti LuPone came down the steps, you know, the steps that they put there for the director to go up. Right. She came down the steps in her costume and everything with this mug in her hand and saying, oh, I've got coffee for Johnny. She always called me to her, got coffee for Johnny. She handed it to me, and I didn't look at it. I just did, it was pure gin.
Oh, God. That made for a calm evening, I'm sure.
Oh, it did. So you know, but there's not a lot of time between, not many years between Gypsy and shows like Cabaret. So, and I know Flora came in between. I know there were other things in between, but you must have done, things must have escalated very quickly.
Well, I was really lucky. Jim and Bill Goldman, who were my brothers, and the three of us lived together.
Oh, did you?
Yes, we had a 9-room apartment all the way west on 72nd Street, looking up the river for $275 a month.
Wow.
We furnished it all through. Anyway, we'd known each other since we were children, and we wanted to do something. And this just giant chutzpah, what I'm telling you, we decided whatever we were going to do, we wanted to do something together first. And we wrote a musical called A Family Affair.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of stories connected with that, but we had a terrible director problem. And Hal Prince, who was a friend, came out to Philadelphia to see it. And he said, "You guys are just, I'm sure you're just being silly and just let Word do his work." And he said, "Well, I'll stay around for one day to observe." And he did stay around for one day. And he said, "If you want me to do it, I'll do it." And for 10 days, he and Ruthie, who was with him, he took over the show. He almost made it work. And that was the first musical, Broadway musical, first musical I ever had on Broadway. It was Hal's first musical that he directed.
Wow.
And
wow. Now, how were you friends, though? Wait a minute, because you became friends after West Side Story, or you were friends?
Oh, no, it had nothing to do with West Side. Actually, I think Billy knew him, maybe.
I see.
I don't know how it all, but this is, it's, the community is very, very small. And the point of that long story about doing dance music and all that is that if you walk through that curtain, I really believe this, and are accepted as a professional, there's no producer that you can't get to at least look at your material. And I was in that lucky position.
Yeah.
And I've had a very easy life, let's put it that way.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah. But you know, decency's got a lot to do with it, and kindness has got a lot to do with it. I mean, it's professionalism, yes, and talent, yes. But there are a lot of ingredients that make that. So tell me about how you met Fred.
It was very simple. We were both assigned to the same publisher. His name was Tommy Volando. And he literally said, and Fred was signed to him too. We didn't know each other. And Tommy said, "I think you two guys should meet each other. I think you'd like each other." And so we did, and we did. And we started writing immediately, and we were unbelievably fertile. I mean, we wrote very fast, and we wrote a lot, and we wrote a lot of shit.
Yeah.
And we tore it up. No, really. We were very, we just liked to write. And if you'd write something one day and then come back and look at it the next day and can't believe that you did that.
Did that rubbish. did you work with your book writers from the beginning?
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Well, let me, there are a couple of exceptions. This is another Hal thing. When we did, he produced Flora, and Hal was he got this from Mr. Abbott, I think, was a terrific leader of a collaboration.
Yeah.
And George Abbott was the director of Flora, but we talked and talked and talked. So when you'd say, do you start off with a book first? In the best experiences that I've had, you start off from ground zero with everybody.
Yeah.
But Hal would, we would have these meetings, and gradually something gets written. And Flora was a flop. And Hal did, there is a point to this story. Hal said 2 weeks before Flora opened, he said, "Whatever happens to to Flora. We'll meet at my apartment the next day and start work on the next piece. And
amazing.
And we did. And it was, we didn't have a title for it then, but there was a room with Hal and Joe Mastroff and Fred and me, and we started to work on the Berlin stories. And we talked 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 endlessly before anything got done.
Sure. Sure.
And I really think that when that doesn't happen, it's really hard.
Yeah.
Because in that way, I'm sorry, Joe Mastroff had some ideas which he had put on paper, but that was it.
Yeah.
And that way, and it was Mr. Abbott's way too, everybody's doing the same piece.
Yeah.
And I just think it must be terribly hard when it's done. Somebody's off in the Virgin Islands writing a book, and then we'll send it in and we'll write songs to it.
Hopeless. But that, I mean, you know, obviously that piece is so wonderful. And that finale ultimo at the end of that piece of theater, it doesn't get any better than that. That kind of putting all those pieces of music together, and it's extraordinary.
But that was talk. That was all talk. And I must say, Hal was wonderfully inventive and a really terrific collaborator and captain of the collaboration.
Yeah.
And so when ideas were coming out, I'm not sure where that idea came from because we were all talking, but it could very well have been Hal who invented it.
Of course.
But
of course, it doesn't matter.
If that ending is really good, and I agree with you, I think it's wonderfully imaginative. It's only there, I think, because we were all doing.
Because of you all.
We were all doing the same piece.
Yeah. Now, of course, we could talk all afternoon, but there are a couple of things that I'd like to talk to you about. And one is your extraordinary loyalty, which is marvelous, to performers. Not just to your writers and your directors, because I know you're loyal to your directors too. I know that to my own advantage. But your loyalty to people like Cheetah is wonderful. And she will acknowledge that. And it's like you're all, I know you've talked about family before, but people like Cheetah, like Liza, that you've presumably written for, I mean, written in mind, yes?
Yes, a lot. Okay, this is going to sound really corny.
Be corny, it's all right.
If that's true, because I really don't think of it a lot, I think it's probably, in great part for me anyway, I can't speak for Fred, because I really was a family person. Yeah. And given all of the insecurity that there is when you're in the arts to begin with, I think instinctively I longed to make art with my friends, and I still do. The things that we do, if you're a writer or director or whatever, all the creating we do is exciting and fun and scary, and sometimes very lonely, or it could be.
Very.
And so when you find people to work with that make you feel that not only whose talent you admire, but who make you feel more secure or free, that's my idea of a good time.
Yeah, it is a good time. It is. But you also have it with, I mean, I know you have that great, wonderful relationship with David Loud, and, you know, so many people like that that I'm also very close to, and I can understand why. I mean, I get why you have people you have around you.
I mean, the idea of doing a show without David would...
The agony.
I would hate that.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. So we met because of Terence, I think, really, in terms of doing the visit. And am I right in remembering that Fred's death happened during the visit? Is that right, John? I can't remember.
Fred died in 2004. So the visit had two previous productions.
Yes.
One in Chicago, and Fred had been very sick before that. I mean, he was late coming to Chicago, as a matter of fact, because he'd been in the hospital and he had oxygen with him.
Yeah.
So I get the dates wrong. I don't know. I think he was probably not in D.C.
And did it feel odd going back to the visit after all those years? There's a big gap in between.
I don't know. It doesn't. I think for one reason, and I think almost all writers that you work with would probably answer this the same way. When Freddie and I did a show, and then maybe years later it was revived. And this is true of all my contemporaries. You look at it and you think, oh shoot, did I write that?
Did I write that rubbish?
And so you go to work on it. And I've always found it interesting because a lot of people who are not in our business look at you and say, oh, they took your song away. They as if that song that you couldn't wait to cut.
Yes.
As if somebody had held you down and took a scissors. And no, we did.
We did it together. We chose that together. I know.
And I know. I'm sure it's got to be true for you because you've done several pieces in Darius productions, and it isn't as if you want to go back and reproduce that production.
No.
Or you might look at it as a guide or something like that, but it's no, I'd much rather be, you know.
Sure. But you and Terence both were incredibly generous. I mean, I can remember you were in every rehearsal, and yet you sat very quietly and sometimes would say something to me in a different world, John. I mean, I can remember the day when you got up, I was doing a scene, and you said to David Loud, wait a minute. And you went to the piano, and it was something that was underscored. And you kind of, with your fingers, I remember you said to him something like, watch me, or listen to this or something. And you kind of rewrote the underscoring in relation to what we were staging. I mean, you don't get that anymore, and that's unique now. It shouldn't be, but it is.
You really think so?
I do.
I'm always a little nervous about saying they don't do that anymore.
I think that level of generosity and understanding that we are all making the same work together in the same moment in time. I'm not saying it's never there anymore, but it's harder to find. I don't know why that should be. I don't know if it's that it's so hard maybe for people to get their piece on that they're more precious of that work. I don't know. I don't know. And maybe it just takes all your years of experience to understand that we all want the same thing.
I think maybe something that gets lost is collaboration. Mm-hmm. Collaboration is terribly important element to me in in after the writing has happened, and after, and then we start to work. And it's what's really fun. I mean, if you had a, I mean, I'm sure this must have happened between us a dozen times. If there was a moment that you wished something, that you felt something was missing, and if and I would probably agree with that, then that well, maybe I can fix it musically to see, and maybe, I don't know, I'm talking garbage, but if this will happen, and if so, if suddenly there's a sudden major chord at that moment.
That's right.
And that's what's fun about all of
that. That's what's fun about it. That's the best bit of the whole thing. Realizing that, as you say, it can take only one chord and it can change an emotional landscape. That's the joy of it all. Now, before we finish, a show that we've never talked about, that I'm hoping that one day you'll say I can do, is The Rink.
Ah.
Cheetah and Liza, of course, and that fantastic score. Why is it not done more, John?
I don't know. I thought, I loved that piece. Oh. It got terrible reviews. And I must say, the audiences all seem to respond to it. But it's I can't, you know something? In the same way that I can't answer why that didn't work, there are some shows that I did that I don't know why they were successful. you ever have that experience? You look at that and you think, and they're cheering for that?
You like this? Oh yes, and then the things that you think, I did really good work there, something really good happened and nobody shows up.
That's right.
or the critics hate it or whatever. I mean, yes, that's part of the game, I think. I don't have a problem with that anymore, but it's fascinating, isn't it?
It is.
How sometimes things have their own time. I mean, you might make a piece of work in a certain time and do it again 20 years later and it works brilliantly. And it's just the world has changed, you know?
You know what's a curious example? I guess the biggest example of that in my life is Chicago.
Chicago
had a modest success when it first came out, very mixed reviews, and then 20 years later,
incredible.
And I don't know what happened, because it's the same piece, it's the same choreographic approach. It's very little of it has changed, but suddenly. People, actually some critics who didn't like it originally did. And I mean, all you have to say is thank you very much. But
thanks for that, yeah.
How do you predict that? I have no idea.
No, I have no idea either. I suppose if we really knew that we would be very good producers. But no. But maybe there was something about, you know, because it started at Encores, didn't it, the second time round? I mean, maybe the very nature that somehow stripped it away. I mean, like, laid it bare was better for it? Who knows?
Have you had that experience with a piece that didn't work the first time and yet then it was revived? And
mm-hmm. What was that? And, you know, I had it with... Steve, the piece that I did of Steve Sondheim and John Wideman's down at the Public Roadshow,
right,
which, you know, got kind of okay reviews, but it was all a little bit lukewarm. It was, you know, and then within 6 months, I did it at the Chocolate Factory in London, and I admittedly the spatial use was different. The relationship between the audience and the actors was different, but it was basically exactly the same. The text wasn't changed, you know, it wasn't all that much that was different. Completely different reaction. Completely different.
Could you explain it?
I think in that case, it was because it was a piece that was looking at America in a, you know, not too positive light, maybe. And the British audience could handle that. They could handle the cynicism maybe of that, the kind of humor, John Weidman's turn of phrase, they could handle that in a way that it was perhaps too close to the American audience. And it was only a short time later. It was not, and we really didn't, we'd done an awful lot of work to get it to where it was at the public, because as you know, it had had productions that bound to various other things that weren't working. And so a lot of work had gone into it, and yet, and so we didn't do all that much in between, but amazing what happened. I actually had slightly the same feeling when I did The Color Purple at the Chocolate Factory and then did it on Broadway. And it was successful at the Chocolate Factory, but it was a whole other thing on Broadway. It's a whole other thing. The audience's relationship with it was entirely different.
Ah.
So there's something about whose story it is, when it is politically, maybe. I don't know, so many things. Because I'm never really interested in going back and working on the ones that were successes. I'm interested in going back and working on the ones that weren't successful. Yeah. You know, trying to get to the bottom of why is, that's what keeps your brain ticking, really, isn't it? You know, John, it's lovely to speak to you. I could speak to you all afternoon.
This is really fun.
Send my love to Albert, won't you?
I sure will.
And take care.
And send my love upstairs.
I certainly will. And enjoy being in that lovely little cabin there. Not sure about cabin, really. It looks rather nice to me. It's funny, this Zoom thing where you can get inside people's homes that you've not been in. It's very peculiar.
Isn't it? It's really weird. I've seen more of my friends this year.
I know. I mean, certainly having family back in Great Britain, I'm glad of this because I wouldn't otherwise see them. So, you know, that's a good thing. Take care, John.
Great to see you. Bye. Much love.
Bye-bye. I hope you enjoyed that just as much as I did. And I also hope that you'll join us on April the 15th for another special event entitled Tell the Story, celebrating Stephen Sondheim and John Weidman's Assassins. This free virtual event will explore the legacy of the musical Assassins through conversations and performances featuring the cast of our forthcoming production, as well as company members from the original 1990 production and the 2004 Broadway production. There will also be many other special guests and a conversation between Stephen Sondheim and John Weidman. So please join us on April the 15th. You can find out more information and register to watch for free at classicstage.org/tell the story.